In this chapter, we're going to look at stoichiometry of chemical reactions. And stoichiometry is what allows us to predict how much product we can make from a certain amount of reactants. And it also allows us to predict how much reactants we would need to make a certain amount of product. And it's very important. You've already learned some of the important parts of stoichiometry, which is converting from grams to moles and moles to grams. It's also converting from molarity and a volume to moles and vice versa. So these are both very important to stoichiometry. But there's one other part that you need to know to do stoichiometry, and that is balanced chemical equations. So later in this chapter, we're going to get into the actual stoichiometry part. But here, first, we're going to talk about balancing chemical equations. One example of where stoichiometry is extremely important is with a rocket ship. It's very important that the rocket fuels are mixed in exact amounts in order to generate this controlled burn, because this thing is essentially a bomb. And if you do have the wrong amounts of things, it either will not be creating thrust or it can actually explode. So it's really important here that the stoichiometry is extremely carefully controlled in order to make this happen. Now, like usual, or like I have done lots of times in the past, I'm going to switch away from the lecture notes for a minute, and I'm going to start to talk about these things in term using the paper, so we can talk about what's going on here. So balanced chemical equations is something you may have seen before. And when it comes to covalent compounds, like if we have H2 gas, which happens to be diatomic, plus O2 gas, when we look at the chemical reaction between these two things, we need to be aware that we're going to form the stable product. And this is the case whether we're doing a covalent reaction or an ionic reaction. Now, in this case, we could tell the product's going to be covalent because we have only nonmetals. So what would be convenient is if nature formed H2O2 hydrogen peroxide. But it turns out that if you mix hydrogen and oxygen, you're not going to form hydrogen peroxide. Hydrogen peroxide, believe it or not, is a relatively unstable molecule. The stuff you buy at the grocery store is 3% hydrogen peroxide. So at that concentration, it's not particularly unstable. But at higher concentrations, this is a pretty dangerous molecule. And this is just not the stable product. It makes sense though, right? Because we have two hydrogens and two oxygens. Why shouldn't we form H2O2? The truth of the matter is, if chemistry worked as simply as this, we probably wouldn't study chemistry, because we could just build molecules like we build Lego sets. Just put atoms together and form what we want to form. But this is not what happens. As you may know, if you mix hydrogen with oxygen, it will explode. And when it explodes, you will form water. The reason for this is water is extremely stable relative to the stability of hydrogen and oxygen. So when you react these two things together, you form something very stable. That energy has to go somewhere because of the law of conservation of energy, and it comes out as an explosion. But what the point is that we form the stable product, water in this case, and we do not form the convenient, if you will, product, H2O2. Now, when it comes to covalent molecules, you are not expected to be able to predict what the stable product is. It will be always given to you. However, if it comes to ionic compounds, as you'll see in a few minutes, you should be able to predict the product of the reaction. So here, what we have is a couple of terminology things that we need to talk about. So on this side of the reaction, we have the reactant or reactants. This in words is yields. And over here we have the product or the products. In this case, there's only one. Now, if we look at this reaction carefully, these reactants, hydrogen and oxygen, yielding this product, water, we notice that we have something impossible going on. Here we have two hydrogens, and here we have two oxygens. Over here we still have two hydrogens, that's good, but we only have one oxygen. Notice we started with two oxygens, and now we only have one oxygen. So it seems as if we have made an oxygen disappear. Well, of course, you know, it's impossible to make oxygen disappear. So we have to fix this. In order to fix this, we use what are called stoichiometric coefficients. And stoichiometric coefficients are numbers that go in front of the reactants that will balance this chemical equation. So if we have O2 here, the minimum number of waters that we can make is 2, because we have 2 oxygens. Well, if we make 2 water molecules, we need 2 times 2. Notice I'm multiplying this, what is called the stoichiometric coefficient, times the subscripted number, which is the number of hydrogens in water. And what we end up with is we need 2 times 2, or 4 hydrogens. Well, if we need 4 hydrogens, we need 2 H2s. Now, if we take a look at this, and I'm going to use the red pen for hydrogen and the blue pen for oxygen, here we have a hydrogen bonded to a hydrogen, but we have 2 of them. This means we have 2 of these, so we have another hydrogen bonded to a hydrogen. Here we have an oxygen bonded to an oxygen. That's what O2 is. And over here we have 2 waters. So in both cases, we have an oxygen in the middle, and that oxygen is bonded to 2 hydrogens in both cases. Note, 2 waters means 2 H2Os, so we have 2 of these. 2 hydrogens means 2 of these, and 1, if there's no number here, means 1 O2. Now let's number these things. 1, 2, 3, 4, and I'm going to number them over here. 1, 2, 3, 4. Oxygens, 1, 2, 1, 2. We now have a balanced chemical equation. Now, you're not going to see it written out this way very often. I'm just doing that to illustrate that we have 4 hydrogens, 4 hydrogens, 2 oxygens, 2 oxygens. You're going to see it written this way. And again, as far as the nomenclature goes, these are the reactants, yields, products. Let's look at another example of covalent compounds. Let's look at H2 gas plus N2 gas yields NH3 gas. So the stable product that it forms when we react hydrogen and nitrogen is ammonia. And this is very important to industrial chemistry, because ammonia is used in the synthesis of many chemicals. So therefore, the industrial production of ammonia is extremely important. So this is an important reaction. Here, the reactants are hydrogen and nitrogen, yields the product ammonia. This is the stable product. Note that this is covalent. How do I know it's covalent? Nonmetals. Nitrogen, hydrogen are both nonmetals. So I have nonmetals reacting to form a covalent compound. So in this case, I need to balance the chemical equation. And again, this is the stable product. So if I have N2, the minimum amount of ammonia I can make is 2 on my product side. I now have 2 times 3, or 6 hydrogens. Well, if I need 6 hydrogens and I have H2, I need 3 H2s. And now we have a balanced chemical equation between hydrogen and nitrogen to form ammonia. In both of these cases, I have covalent compounds forming. For covalent compounds, you will be given the product, with one exception, which is a combustion reaction, which we'll talk about shortly. In a combustion reaction, you are expected to know the products of the reaction. So a combustion reaction involves reacting a hydrocarbon, in this case my example is going to be CH4, which is methane, and oxygen, O2, to form products. When we burn hydrocarbons are molecules that contain carbon and hydrogen, in the presence of oxygen, we make stable products, carbon dioxide and water. Since it's hot, the water is probably a gas. So this is like burning natural gas. This is also how a car goes down the road, for example. You wouldn't use methane, probably. Some cars do use it, but gasoline contains hydrocarbons as well. So the stable products of a combustion reaction are carbon dioxide and water. This is combustion. And it's important that you know the products of this reaction. These are covalent, but you are expected to know that burning a hydrocarbon gives you carbon dioxide and water. In the case of ammonia or water from hydrogen and oxygen, you'll be given the product, but here you wouldn't. When you're balancing a combustion reaction, it's a good idea to balance carbon, then hydrogen, then oxygen. The truth is, it doesn't matter if you do carbon or hydrogen first. What's important is you do oxygen last. And the reason you want to do oxygen last is it's in both products. So it'll be much easier if we do it last. So let's take a look at this. One good way to remember that you should do carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen is that's generally the order they come in. It's usually the hydrocarbon plus oxygen. So carbon, then hydrogen, then oxygen. So let's look at this. All of the carbon in the hydrocarbon goes into carbon dioxide. So if I have 1C here, I should have 1C here. Carbon is balanced. All of the hydrogen of the hydrocarbon goes into water. So if I have 4Hs here, I need to make 2 waters. So I can have a total of 4 hydrogens. Now we want to carefully balance oxygen. Here we have 2 oxygens in CO2 plus 2 times 1, or 2 more oxygens from water, for a total of 4 oxygens on my product side. Well, if I have 4 oxygens on my product side, I need 2 O2s, so I have 4 oxygens on my reactant side. So there is balancing a combustion reaction. Let's look at a slightly more complex example. Let's look at C4H10 gas plus oxygen gas. This is butane, like you'd find in a lighter, reacting with oxygen. It doesn't matter how many carbons and hydrogens you have. If you have just carbons and hydrogens and you burn it in the presence of oxygen, your products will be carbon dioxide and water. So burning hydrocarbons in the presence of oxygens yields carbon dioxide and water, independent of their structure. This is, again, a combustion reaction. So we want to do carbon, then hydrogen, then oxygen. All of the carbon of the hydrocarbon goes into carbon dioxide. So if I have 4 here, I need 4 here. All of the hydrogen goes into water. So if I have 10 here, I need 5 waters, because each water contains 2 hydrogens. Now let's look. Let's do oxygen. 4 times 2 is 8 oxygens. Whoops. And 5 times 1 is 5 oxygens, for a total of 13 oxygens. And you can see we have a problem. 13 oxygens and we have O2. You can't put 6.5. These must be whole numbers. So therefore, we can't just put 6.5. The easiest way to deal with this is to simply double everything. This 1 becomes a 2. This 4 becomes an 8. This 5 becomes a 10. And now this 13 becomes 26 oxygens. So if you need 26 oxygens, you need 13 O2s. Notice that balancing, and not just for combustion reactions, but for all balancing, is a guess and check method. Sometimes your first best guess, 4 and 5, didn't work out because we had an odd number of oxygens. So we had to double everything so we could get an even number of oxygens and then balance the chemical equation. So this is balancing a combustion reaction. The last thing I want to look at is balancing ionic reactions. In ionic reactions, we're going to have something a little bit different going on. In the case of an ionic reaction, you can actually figure out the products of the reaction. So let's look at an example. Let's say we have sodium solid plus oxygen gas yields. How can you instantly tell that you will have an ionic product? Well, your product is going to have sodium in it. So if your product is going to have sodium in it, it's going to be ionic. So here we can actually figure out the stable product. Remember that the stable product is going to be based on the charge. So Na is in 1A, so the product is going to contain Na plus. Oxygen is in 6A, so the product is going to contain O2 minus. Cross them, and what you end up with for your product is Na2O. Note that ionic compounds tend to have high melting and boiling points. So, for the most part, they're going to be solids. Note that an exception to that is if there's water around, because some ionic compounds can dissolve in water, in which case they'll be aqueous. But here there's no water around. This is a solid, this is a gas, nothing's aqueous, so there's no water around. All right, now that we've found our stable product based on the charges, we can balance the coefficients. notice that I can't just put that the product is NaO2. That would be super convenient. Na plus O2 yields NaO2, but that's not how the charges balance out. So we need to find the stable product. So we need to balance again. If we have O2 here, the minimum number of these we can make is 2 on our product side. And if we have two Na2Os, we have 2 times 2, or a total of 4 sodiums. So now we have a balanced chemical equation. The last one I want to go over is another ionic compound that we can form. Let's say that we react aluminum with chlorine gas to yield some product. So again, we can tell that this is going to be an ionic compound because we have a metal reacting with a nonmetal. Well, if we find aluminum on the periodic table, it's in 3A. So Al, I'm going to move up, Al is 3+, and chlorine on the periodic table is in 7A, so it's Cl-. Cross them, just like we did in the previous chapter, and you find that it's AlCl3, and again, it's ionic. There's no water around because nothing's aqueous, so it's solid. So now we have the product of our reaction. Now we need to balance. Well, if we look here, we have a problem. We have 2 Cls here and 3 here. So we need a common denominator. To do that, we put a 2 here, which gives us 2 times 3, which is 6. And then we put a 3 here, which gives us 3 times 2, which is 6, the common denominator being 6. So we need to find a common number between 2 and 3, which is 6, and that balances out. Now, if we have 2 AlCl3s, we need 2 aluminums. So we put a 2 there, and we now have a balanced chemical equation. This is how we balance chemical equations in chemistry. The last thing that I want to look at is a couple types of chemical reactions, and you will learn others in the next section. But here, I want to learn 3 types of chemical reactions. So let's look at a combination reaction. Whoops. A combination reaction is A plus B yields AB. And in the homework, you may be asked to identify different types of reactions as combination reactions, or decomposition or combustion that we're going to look at here. So this is a combination reaction. We already looked at one of these. We actually looked at a couple of these. But the one of the ones we looked at was 3H2 gas plus N2 gas yields 2NH3 gas. So this is a combination reaction. We have 2 chemicals combining to form 1 chemical. That's a combination reaction. The decomposition is the opposite. Decomposition is AB yields A plus B. And one of the reactions that we do in the lab here is CuSO4.5H2O, solid. This is copper 2 sulfate pentahydrate. If you heat this up, you get CuSO4, solid. This is anhydrous copper 2 sulfate plus 5 waters. So one compound, this happens to be a hydrate, decomposes to form 2 compounds. Usually you do this at elevated temperature, so the water is going to be a gas. And the final one we talked about several times, which is a combustion reaction, and it has a general form, CXHY, which just means some numbers of carbons and hydrogens plus oxygen yields carbon dioxide plus water. And this is just the general form. These are generally gases. This one, usually a gas as well. And we already looked at an example of this, CH4, methane, which is a gas, plus 2O2, which is a gas, yields CO2, which is a gas, plus 2 water as a gas. So this is a combustion reaction. So these are 3 general types of reactions. You could be given this reaction and ask which of the 3 it is, or this one, or this one. And as I said, we'll look at a couple more examples in the next section.